I'm Angel Cooper, and the name of my project is Domination, Individuality, and Moral Chaos, Nietzsche's Will to Power. One of the most well-known but deeply debated ideas presented by the philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche is the will to power. Scholars have provided a variety of interpretations of this concept. I argue that under each interpretation, Nietzsche may face what I call the problem of moral chaos, or the problem of endorsing violent immoral acts such as murder and torture as examples of the human will achieving power over others. I ultimately argue that Nietzsche's philosophy avoids this problem. Although Nietzsche proposes it is possible to harm others as a way to power, we should not direct our will to power in this way. This argument is important as this concept has been dangerously misinterpreted in the past, a la the Nazi stigma attached to it in the 20th century. And so it is important to show that Nietzsche does not condone such immoral acts. To do this, I investigate common interpretations of the will to power, arguing that the psychological interpretation is the most compelling. From here, I argue that Nietzsche clearly inspires humanity to direct the will to power towards individual inner growth and not as a form of domination. There are three different interpretations of the will to power: the metaphysical, metaphorical, and psychological interpretations. Those who explain the will to power as a metaphysical description of nature assert that Nietzsche expresses the will to power as being the nature of reality and of all things inorganic or organic. There are two essential components to this interpretation: human beings and the world. Regarding human beings, the will to power is emphasized as something real in human behavior. A being is presented as different forces of energy that are constantly fighting for power. This power must be commanded to promote a healthy individual. If it is not, and one force has excess power in deficient areas, then the individual is insufficient, sick, or weak. Meanwhile, the world is also understood as the will to power. For instance, in Beyond Good and Evil, there is one passage that treats all things as reducible to one underlying metaphysical substance that Nietzsche calls the will to power. Although things in nature are consuming other things in an act for power and growth, all things in nature are consuming other things in an act for power and growth. As Nietzsche puts it, quote, "This world is the will to power and nothing besides, and you yourselves are also this will to power and nothing besides," end quote. Thus, following this interpretation, we are a force of power, where power is a drive in everything to move outward and consume space. Although the metaphysical interpretation can be supported in Nietzsche's writings, I argue that there are several problems with this interpretation. First, it is based primarily on Nietzsche's notes, not his published works. But it is inadequate to base an interpretation primarily on his notes, as it is likely that these ideas are undeveloped. Second, this interpretation is inconsistent with Nietzsche's view of perspectivism, the epistemic claim that we can only have knowledge and understanding through our human perspective. We cannot see the metaphysically real world, but only a world that is envisioned through our human perspective. Therefore, we can never truly know anything about nature. However, the metaphysical interpretation implies that we can have knowledge about nature, since nature truly is the will to power. Thus, there is an inconsistency between this interpretation and Nietzsche's perspectivism. Finally, most of Nietzsche's passages on the will to power are described only in humanity, and the few passages that seem to suggest a metaphysical interpretation can be explained in a non-metaphysical sense. For these reasons, I dismiss the metaphysical interpretation. The next view, the metaphorical interpretation, maintains that since we cannot know anything about the metaphysical world, we must create a fiction for the human world, or the world we can know. Nietzsche does this by creating the will to power as a fictional worldview. The will to power is thus not real in nature or humanity, but is, as Wayne Klein puts it, quote, "one way among others of describing nature, a form of description that Nietzsche recognizes as explicitly metaphorical," end quote. Nietzsche describes it as, quote, "For the game of creation, my brothers, a sacred yes is needed," end quote. Here, the game of creation is a fiction that establishes value in life, allowing us to embrace life and derive strength from it. I maintain that this interpretation falls short as well. First, there are passages from Nietzsche's works that describe the will to power as a psychological drive in all humanity, which cannot be explained by the metaphorical interpretation. For example, Nietzsche explains that each human being has a will to power and hence, quote, "belongs to the essence of what lives. As a basic organic function, it is a consequence of the will to power," end quote. Here, Nietzsche is proposing that the will to power is an observed psychological trait in humanity, and not just any trait, but the trait that motivates human beings to live. The metaphorical interpretation cannot explain this passage, as Nietzsche makes no indication here that he implies the will to power as a psychological metaphor. Rather, it is a literal psychological characteristic. Second, the metaphorical interpretation doesn't provide criteria to determine which passages and ideas of Nietzsche's are fictional and which are not. Here, the metaphorical interpretation faces a slippery slope. If the will to power is considered a fiction and there is no criterion to determine fictions from truths about the human world, then all of Nietzsche's explanations are fictitious. But this entails an inconsistency with Nietzsche's purported truths about the human world. Thus, due to these reasons, I reject the metaphorical interpretation. The final interpretation, the psychological interpretation, emphasizes the will to power as a secondary drive that influences first-order drives. That is, it is a drive to overcome or improve our desires, activities, and passions. For instance, one may have a first-order drive to be a writer, while the secondary drive, the will to power, underlies this desire and psychologically motivates one to become better as a writer. As Rex Welshen explains, power for Nietzsche is striving to better one's own activities and passions. Nietzsche suggests this in The Genealogy of Morals, as he describes the will to power as, quote, "the strongest, most life-affirming drive," end quote, and states that we are, quote, "obedient to the same basic instinct," end quote. The will to power is thus a drive in humanity and an instinct inherent in us. Furthermore, Welshen notes that the will to power shapes a specific desire by constructing a new ability and changing not just this person's one ability, but their whole self. This is related to Nietzsche's notion of self-overcoming, as the will to power allows us to overcome ourselves by changing or growing, which reconstructs our whole being. I maintain that one can defend the psychological reading of the will to power from common objections presented against it. The first objection holds that this interpretation cannot account for Nietzsche's obvious endorsement of humanity creating a fictitious world in passages where Nietzsche speaks of philosophers creating truths and openly accepts that we create the world through images. However, if we consider the will to power a human truth about human psychology through Nietzsche's perspectivism, then this interpretation is still consistent with such passages. In this case, the will to power as a psychological drive urges philosophers specifically to derive truths from their own values about the metaphysical world. But since they cannot find such truths, they create fictions. Thus, following the psychological interpretation, the will to power is a human truth, meaning it is something we can observe in humanity through the human perspective. We recognize it as a drive that motivates us to create an image of the world through our values. A second objection holds that the will to power cannot be an underlying psychological drive for human beings because a primary desire must be prior to the existence of a secondary drive. As such, the will to power would fail to exist in its own right. This objection fails, however, as it is conceivable for the will to power to exist independent of any other drive. It is common to feel the need to struggle and better oneself without that need first being inspired from a specific desire. I may love to write, but my desire to write better could come from the general motivation or desire to overcome all obstacles. Also, I may feel the desire to master any skill so as to better myself or be the best at something, where the activity I am mastering is of less importance than the feeling of mastering something. It is possible then for one to have a drive to struggle before having a desire. As Nietzsche puts it, quote, what does not kill me makes me stronger, end quote, thereby suggesting the inherent value of struggling itself. The psychological interpretation is the most accurate account of the will to power. With this in mind, we can now examine whether or not the will to power leads to the problem of moral chaos. It is clear from his writing that Nietzsche recognizes harmful acts towards others as a possible expression of the will to power. He describes the will to power in individuals who become stronger through domination over others. He also describes the will to power in the weak as tyranny, domination, and oppression of others, which allows them to derive strength through the superiority they feel in hurting others. But even though Nietzsche recognizes that violent acts can be a way to increase one's power, the important question we must ask is, does Nietzsche maintain that we should use violent acts as a way to increase our power? If so, then the problem of moral chaos arises, because he would endorse a society whose members torture, murder, and manipulate others for their own gain. However, if not, then Nietzsche avoids the problem of moral chaos because he will promote a society whose individuals focus on themselves in an effort to self-overcome and will not dominate and harm others as a means for strength. Following Walter Kaufmann, I maintain that Nietzsche does not encourage humanity to direct their will to power towards domination. What is important for Nietzsche is that the will to power is a drive to overcome, not that one can be driven to violence. This drive towards self-overcoming inspires us to be beyond what we are today. And for Nietzsche, this is life-affirming, which is one of his most esteemed aspirations. In Twilight of the Idols, we may identify Nietzsche's admiration of overcoming, as well as his disregard for either a domineering ruler or a weak slave for others to rule. He writes, quote, how is freedom measured in individuals? One would have to seek the highest type of free man where the greatest resistance is constantly being overcome. 5 steps from tyranny near the threshold of the danger of servitude, end quote. Here Nietzsche explains that the highest man is one who must always overcome. But this man is not a tyrant, because if he were, he would care only for what he acquired and not for his inner growth and personal strength. Nietzsche makes it clear here that the highest man, what he refers to as the overman, is the one who is neither a tyrant dominating weaker beings nor a servant who cannot rule himself. Not only does Nietzsche expect us to avoid becoming tyrants in the quest for power, but there is a point where the highest man can be more merciful and less harmful than we are today. Nietzsche maintains that the will to power may lead us to become so strong a society of individuals that we will not need to punish or harm others. He equates the act of mercy in a society to its overcoming itself, which is something he regards as beautiful. Following Kaufmann, we can say that such acts are part of Nietzsche's ideal direction of the will to power, since although, quote, the will to power may be ruthless and a source of evil doing, power itself does not corrupt but ennobles the mind, end quote. Mercy, then, is one form of nobility. Thus, Nietzsche finds this expression of the will to power superior to an expression of strength derived from violence. Although Nietzsche does not acknowledge violence and domination as a form of the will to power, I argue that this is only a descriptive tool for him. He uses this type of man to illustrate strength and counters it with those who embody weak wills. However, Nietzsche does not encourage us to be like these individuals, but like the overman. I find that Nietzsche's notion of the will to power does not lead to the problem of moral chaos. Nietzsche does not propose violence, murder, or torture of others as a viable or worthwhile form of the will to power, and is not led to a chaotic society where all individuals struggle solely for their own personal advancement by any means necessary. Instead, he inspires us to become overmen, individuals who have such attributes as strength, bravery, and manners, and who aspire to live in a society in which there may be mercy for others, not domination of them. Nietzsche here advocates society that is not chaotic or psychotic, but instead strong, merciful, and always overcoming itself. A society whose members will advance beyond revenge and punishment and will be able to have healthy conflict with one another. In this way, Nietzsche therefore avoids the problem of moral chaos.